Okay, now that we've verified that the inverter is operational and the system's safe to inspect, we're at the array. So right now we're on the roof. We're looking across the array here, and we've identified the part we're going to inspect at this time. We want to refer to our drawings. Again, we're going to be on page E3-1. This drawing can be a little bit confusing. You're going to see that there's a lot of arrays, but you want to find some geographical reference here. We can see there's a large outcropping, you know, directly in front of where we are and to the left and the right. We're going to use those distinct building features to identify where we're at on the plan. First thing we're going to want to do is verify that the number of PV modules matches the plans and specs. Now, on a job like this, that could take some time. Some ways that you might consider doing that is being a part of the commissioning process. So typically, inspectors, we don't care about how well this system performs. We just care if it's safe. But one thing we need to do is we need to verify that none of these strings are configured in such a way that we're going to have an overvoltage situation. So as that pertains to this job, that would be over 600 volts. So I've already verified that with a previous inspection on this project. So for now, what we're going to really look at is we're going to look at the module mounting system, make sure that it matches the plans and specs. We're going to look at how the wires underneath the array are managed and the grounding of all of those pieces. Okay, now underneath the array, what we're going to look for is we're going to look to identify a few things. We want to identify the equipment grounding conductor. As you can see, it runs across the underside of the modules. It terminates on a lug there to the left side. We can see that there are some little grounding jumpers, and they go from the supporting structure to the module frames themselves. And we've reviewed the code and found this to be acceptable for this application. What's important, though, is that the hardware mounting all of that, the lugs and the little jumper wires, be corrosion resistant. So in this case, the contractors use stainless steel hardware, and that's more than acceptable for this application. Now, the other thing we're going to be concerned about is wire management. We don't want any wires touching the ground. So we've got wires coming off of all of the modules, and we've got the runs, the source circuits, as they run from the modules back down underneath, and then they enter a raceway and head back over to the combiner box. Just to be clear, during a previous inspection, these wind deflectors would not be installed. This is installed as a part of the final installation and the final inspection. Obviously, we cannot see underneath here. We don't have access, but at an earlier inspection, there's been quite a few on this project. We had them off. We saw what was going on underneath there, and we approved that installation methodology. So like we said in the introduction, it's important that you coordinate with your electrical inspector, like they did here, to ensure that you can get access to all that. And what's important to the installer, again, is that this is a visual inspection. So if I can't see it, I can't inspect it, which means I'm not responsible. So you want to make sure that the inspector or the authority having jurisdiction has full access to the site. What we have to do now in the final inspection is just ensure the connections underneath are done with the equipment grounding conductor and that the inner racking grounding, as we can see down here, two modules down, there's a jumper and that's bonding the rails together. Again, there we want to make sure that that jumper is per the specs that we've already previously approved and that the fasteners are suitable for this environment. In this case, they're stainless steel. Okay, another thing that is commonly done wrong at the array location is the source circuit conductor coming off of the module has a factory installed crimp. Now, oftentimes what installers will do is they'll remove that crimp and what they'll do is just butt splice that to the source circuit conductor heading back to the combiner box. This is an issue with voiding the listing of the module. It's listed as an assembly, and you're going to get into a whole lot of other issues as the AHJ if you're trying to approve this new piece of equipment in this new environment and condition that there's no test for. Of course, you could do that as the AHJ. That's your prerogative, but for myself, I like to avoid those situations and stay with all the listed tested equipment. Here we can see in the picture a typical connection style. Now this is completely right. We've got the connector coming from the module and the connector crimp that was installed by the contractor. We can see those plugged together, and that's what we would expect to see. In this next picture, what we have is a picture of where that connector has been removed by the contractor, and there's been a crimp and some heat shrink installed. Now again, as the AHJ, you could approve that equipment, you could approve that installation, but I would say you're taking on liability that is not necessary. The right parts are available out there to put the crimp on from with the proper connector that would mate right up with the module. And once we get done this part of the inspection, we're going to follow the raceway that leaves the array back over to the combiner box. And then we're going to start our inspection of the combiner box system there.